today's Transport Evolved, EV networks prepare to charge for plugging in, BYD's E6 gets dropped by green tomato cars, Tesla stock soars, the BMW i3 Rex isn't on the HOV lane list for California yet, and the stickers are running out. And why Renault needs to make a Zoe GT. Coming up next on Transport Evolved. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and welcome to episode number 188 of Transport Evolved, recorded on Sunday, 23rd of February 2014. My name is Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield.
And I'm Mark Chatterley. How are you today, Nikki?
I'm very well, thank you. How are you, Mark?
I'm new. I'm good. I'm in a new place.
You are in a new place. Do you like it?
It does look like you have trapped me with some sort of magic in a box in your studio, though.
No. It's called a monitor, Mark. Don't worry about it. I hope you've had a good week. I hope the weather's been pretty good to you. For those of you who are watching at home and going, where's the brick wall? Over the last couple of months, people started to comment more and more that our brick wall was obviously not a brick wall. And it got to the point where I went, you know what? The brick wall is a green screen, as you all knew. It took up a lot of studio space in a studio which is absolutely tiny. And so we decided we'd go back old school. Mark said it was like the 1990s, didn't you, Mark?
I do. We decided it was a bit like Philip Schofield in his in the
BBC
closet.
And his broom closet in the 1990s with Gordon the Gopher. I do not have a sock puppet, though.
Which means we might start inviting in viewer pictures and we could hold them up.
That would be brilliant. Someone has to do that for next week. You can see the bevy of computers behind me doing the show. And you can also see our guest today joining us for the first time. Now, welcome to the show, Seth Weinstrass. He is a global IT specialist, reporter actually, award-winning journalist, works for 9to5 Mac currently and also works for electrek.co, which I believe is your own site, Seth.
That's correct.
Yeah, so welcome to the show. Now, you're here today because of one particular story piqued my interest this week, and I read your coverage of it and I thought we have to get you on the show. That's in the second half, but I'm hoping you can talk to us about some of the other stories. Tell us about Electrek. How long have you been running that?
Electrek's about 8 months old. It started right after I bought my Tesla Model S.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I was a big fan, and obviously, I'm a blogger and I cover a bunch of areas. So this was kind of a hobby, I guess.
Yeah.
To put it in, and it's starting to get some pickup. So maybe it'll turn into a real job.
Well, you know what, Seth? That's how Mark and I got into our sector. I, like you, used to cover tech side and Macs. Used to work for Mac Format back in the UK many years ago. Trained as a classical musician originally, but now working exclusively in EVs. And this is our little domain, isn't it, Mark? You too. You are part of the team as well.
Thank you. Thank you for including me as part of the team.
You've done all the hard work. I mean, you do all the hard work with the video editing and everything else. Final Cut Pro, genius. By the way, I just want to thank Apple support. For anyone who says Apple support's not any good, telephone support, because that's been my experience in the past. We had trouble this week with Final Cut Pro, and I rang up the tech support line for the very first time, and I explained the problem fairly succinctly to a lovely French guy who rang me back about 4 hours later with a workaround. So Mark and I were going to talk about that and how we can implement it in the shows for future. But enough talking about the tech, on with the show. So this week there's been some two stories simultaneously running at the same time, one in Washington State and one in the UK. And they both concern paying to charge. Now, Seth, as a Model S owner, you never have this problem. But for anyone who's not a Model S owner, Mark and I both own Leafs. I also own a Chevy Volt. We have to pay, potentially in the future, we are going to have to pay every time we plug in at a public charging location. UK-based Chargemaster this week reiterated its plans to charge customers for using public charging stations from April 1st. And while there are no official price lists or tariffs, as Chargemaster was very careful to point out, they wanted to call them, no official tariffs yet, they will allow pay-as-you-go charging. But Mark, in the past, Chargemaster's got a bit of a reputation for charging over the odds, hasn't it?
Yeah, so when it launched in the UK, which was, blimey, 2.5 years ago, maybe 3 yeah. years ago yeah. now, they came out with a range of tariffs. And depending on whether you had a home charging unit or not, there were different prices. But if you went for just the public charging, which is what I would have had, it was a £95 joining fee. You then had to pay a monthly fee of £19.50. And then on top of that, you had to pay 95p every time you charged. And to say it caused a little bit of a stir in the EV world, it would be an understatement. It was, quite frankly, a ridiculous amount to pay for access to a charging network that had just started. I mean, at this point, they didn't have many charging stations in the ground. And it was all, we will have X many by this date, which I don't think they hit many of their targets, to be fair. There was a bit of to-ing and fro-ing. We tried to speak to, or rather you, because it was you at the time, tried to speak to the person who runs that organization. And there was a wonderful quote, and this is paraphrasing a little bit, but pretty much came back of EV drivers are rich and can afford to pay.
Yep.
Which didn't endear them to the UK public. Eventually, there was so much backlash, and it was constant on their Facebook pages. They started banning people on their Facebook pages that they went, okay, we'll change it. And it became a £10 yearly fee
right.
and free charging,
yeah.
which they claimed was pay-as-you-go, but they were just waiving the pay-as-you-go fee.
Now, it's
was a lot better.
Sorry, Mark. I was going to say, it's an important thing to note that charging infrastructures do cost a lot of money to put in. And they have to make their money somewhere.
Yes,
sort of in tandem with this, the West Coast Electric Highway in Washington State, which is great. You can drive the whole length of I-5. Actually, the West Coast Electric Highway is Oregon and Washington State. So you could theoretically drive from Vancouver in Canada over the border into America, all the way south through Washington and then to Vancouver, Washington, over the border into Portland, Oregon, and all the way down to the tip of Northern California in about, I think you can do that in a day, maybe two, in a Leaf, stopping every 50 miles and rapid charging. And that was a part of a government funded project at the West Coast Electric Highway. It got federal and state funding, like the Chargemaster networks and some of the other networks in the UK got UK government funding.
Yeah.
On April 1st, they too will go with a charge to use system, but they've been very upfront about it. $20 a month for unlimited use, which is brilliant. And $7.50 pay as you go if you don't want a membership card. Now, I think that's really reasonable, Seth. That's a pretty good price, right? And how these guys have got to make their money some way.
Yeah, I agree. There's going to be a private network. There has to be some sort of motivation to put something up like that. And you know, I guess the market will kind of decide the prices as more and more of these networks start coming up. I didn't hear earlier. Are these like the fast charging DC ones or these
DC,
like the 30 amp?
Yeah, these are the DC CHAdeMO okay. charging. It certainly in the US,
okay.
But in the UK, yeah. it will be just level two fast charging, which is
okay.
You know, and then that's a good point. It's not necessarily worth paying unless you're right. going to be somewhere all day.
And again, that's where it starts coming into the cost benefit. There is an argument that charging at 7 kilowatts is quite useful. You can charge a Leaf if it's capable, or most EVs if it's capable, in about 4 hours. But that's still 4 hours. You need to be able to do something while that is happening. And how much are you willing to charge for that? Especially when there are people who offer charging as part of your experience. Like there are... in Bristol, you can go to the shopping malls in Bristol and charge your car for free because you just charge where you're parked. And it works. If I need to go to a shopping mall, I go to Bristol. And even though Cheltenham and Gloucester are closer to me, I go to Bristol because I can charge. And it actually drives me there. So it's quite interesting. The cost is going to have to be fairly cheap, but then they're trying to support the infrastructure of a charging network. And that's where it starts getting interesting with the fast charge. When you throw in rapid charge, it becomes a lot easier to charge money for it. Yes. Because there's a definite benefit to it. I can travel 170 miles in a day easily, or 300 miles in a day relatively easily, because I'm using rapid charging rather than fast charging.
But we should probably point out, in the UK, certainly, the only charging network that currently has a rapid charging capability of any kind of network to speak of is Ecotricity, and they're currently free. And I've actually just switched my electricity supply over to them. They are a utility company. It's the only utility company that also runs a charging network. And I'm supporting them at the moment because of their network. Seth, obviously, Tesla's model is very different. Tesla has this pay when you buy the car. It's all rolled in. Do we think that Tesla's model is going to be adopted by other automakers? Tesla's been very clear and said, you know, look, you can come on board if you subscribe to our ethos.
Obviously there's a premium there, and I don't know that that model works for everybody. If the cost is, you know, say it's $10,000 over the life of the car to put a charging network in, perhaps people would be more open to the idea of, you know, paying per charge or per, you know, in a subscription plan. I'm not sure. I mean, to be honest with you, I didn't buy the Tesla based on the supercharger network. That's kind of a bonus that was thrown in. I got it in early. I knew that they had planned a supercharger network, but at the time I got it, it was maybe three or four superchargers in California, so it wasn't. I'm in New York on the other side of the country, so it wasn't something I was planning to use. Now that it's out there, though, now I can drive to California or pretty much anywhere in the country. It's a big plus.
Yeah.
And I'm obviously very happy about that.
And I've got to say, the quality of the difference I note is that here in the UK, it's one charger per site, pretty much, or maybe a couple of fast chargers per site. You know, I stopped at the Delaware supercharger site on I-95 2 weeks ago when I was over there. Mm-hmm. And it's phenomenally well built. It's beautiful to look at. It's almost a piece of artwork. And Tesla, I think that they certainly have caused the industry, I think, to rethink the way that charging is provided. Let's move on. Green Tomato Cars, Mark. It's a UK-based minicab company in London. They've been around for, what, a decade now, made a name for themselves?
Yeah.
And their USP has always been, we will provide you with an eco-friendly taxi cab. For those who don't know, London, for many years, has been dominated by black cabs. The black cabs have been traditionally diesel engine vehicles, at least for the, you know, in recent memory, for the last 20, 30 years. They've been horribly polluting. Lots of smog, despite London Mayor and Transport for London working to clean up the particulate filters. Diesel engines are not clean. So Green Tomato Cars is a minicab company that's been using Toyota Priuses, or Prii, depending on what you want to call them, to provide those minicab services, and you pay a premium because you're using a green vehicle. I'd never quite understood that, but hey. They, a long time ago, signed an order with BYD, the Chinese battery manufacturer turned automaker, to bring the E6 into the US, into the UK, with an idea of using these 50 BYD E6 electric cars to supplement its fleet of Priuses, to offer all electric vehicles to do, you know, the runs to the airport or whatever from the centre of town. This week, Green Tomato Cars and BYD mutually cancelled the contract. And walked away. BYD is not talking reasons. Green Tomato Cars is not talking reasons. Green Tomato Cars has said, we're still supporting plug-in vehicles. We still will buy plug-in vehicles.
And said that they are very much looking at the Model S.
The Model S, which is... You can't really compare those two vehicles, can you? The E6 and the Model S are completely different.
And it's interesting because... The lack of information is making people jump to conclusions, which is probably bad for BYD. If they had a reason and they knew the reason, they should have released it, because the only place that people are jumping to is the car couldn't live up to what was promised. And that may or may not be right, but without the information to counteract that, that's the most obvious conclusion. And especially when a quote from someone from Green Tomato Cars says, we've been looking at the Tesla Model S, which is a very impressive electric car, which rivals its ICE equivalents. They did also throw in a line about looking at hydrogen cars, but that was...
I think they've said they're going to test the Hyundai hydrogen car, which is the iX35, I think. I think you guys called it Tucson over there. Can't think of the American name for it. But anyway, the first hydrogen car from Hyundai. And, you know, I can't help but wonder if when Green Tomato Car signed this contract, the BYD E6 was maybe the best thing out there for them for that particular need. And now Nissan's coming out with its ENV200, Taxi of Tomorrow, for London, both in petrol and diesel formats, petrol and electric formats. The electric one is due this summer in the UK as in a test fleet. I think you've already got one running around New York City, Seth.
I believe so.
Yeah. I mean, I saw so many of the petrol cars when I was over there. They were stacked on dealer forecourts. It was really impressive. And you know, I think Green Tomato Cars just got cold feet. Who would you rather go with? Would you rather go with a name that you know and you've used before? Or would you rather go with a company that's effectively, and I don't want to upset BYD, dipping their toes in the market, certainly outside of China, right, Seth? I mean, this is computer technology all over again. This is the quality versus price, right?
Right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. BYD over here is nothing. I don't think it's even as big as I think people know Green Tomato over BYD, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I mean, it's I think over here, nobody really has heard of BYD. We've had a bit of a run-in with one of their press people who's telling us off for a video we made a couple of months ago. Go watch it. It's on YouTube. It's a hill test of the BYD E6. Make your own decisions. Hand on heart, we stopped on the Millbrook Hill circuit. We checked behind us to make sure no one was bombing around behind us. It was technically not allowed. We still did it because we wanted to see how it did on the hillside.
And we also weren't going very fast around that corner anyway.
We were
doing
about 10 miles an hour when we came to stop anyway. All right, moving on before I get myself into hot water.
I was just going to say just one more thing. I wondered if it was partly to do with them having seen the car. I imagine when they signed the contract, they hadn't seen the car and it was all on specs. I would have been very surprised if they'd seen the car. And when you look in the back of the BYD E6 and you think about someone going to the airport, they're going to have two or three suitcases with them. They're going to have carry-on suitcases for them. And you open up the boot of the BYD and there's no space. It's just flat in front of you. There's no recess, because that's where all the batteries are, but a massive amount of batteries that are in there. In terms of being fit for purpose, regardless of anything else to do with performance of that car, it's not a taxi car. There isn't a lot of space to store luggage. There may be quite a lot of space to sit in, but in terms of storing luggage, you're quite limited. And I just wondered whether it was they saw the car and went, actually, for a taxi, this isn't quite fit for purpose.
Quite possibly. All right. Geneva Motor Show coming up next month, actually. We're really excited about this car. It's got an engine. I'm sorry to say, Mark, you are not allowed to say anything about Monday. It has an engine. and it's a plug-in hybrid from Volkswagen. It's the GTE. GTE, the E stands for electric. It is fairly well-specced, Mark. And I think... it's going to get lots of people buying it. And I think it's going to even give cars like the Vauxhall Ampera, which is the Chevy Volt, a bit of a hard time. Mark. Give us a rundown on the specs.
I don't know the specs off by heart, sorry. And I haven't
I'll
got the
run
page
you down.
In front of me.
All right, so 147 horsepower, 1.4-litre turbocharged stratified fuel injection engine, 6-speed triple clutch DSG gearbox, and I think it's a 70-something or 80 kilowatt motor driving the front wheels as well.
It's really interesting because I was my dad worked for Volkswagen, and quite a lot of people in my family have worked for Volkswagen for a while. And I was talking about this car. He left Volkswagen a number of years ago, so he had no idea this was coming out. And when I told him about it, the first question was, "It's fully electric." And I was like, "No." And my dad's still a bit skeptical about fully electric cars, which is fine, even though I've driven a number of miles on them, but he's still skeptical. But when I told him it was a plug-in hybrid based around the Golf GT, he suddenly got really interested in it. And when telling me it could go about 20-ish, 25 miles, probably on all electric mode, he was going, well, that's, you can go to the shops and back. But then he started thinking about electric motors and their torque and how that's probably actually going to help it get off the line slightly faster. And he suddenly got really interested in it. And I could see this being, we've always talked about how electric cars will save the petrol cars for the people who really into petrol cars and driving. They will have their petrol car they drive at the weekend, just like people have horses that they ride at the weekends now. Mm. Petrol cars will become that kind of fun play thing.
Yeah.
I can see this car filling that need. I could see myself having, if I had much more money, my Leaf, and then my Golf GTE, and the Golf would be the car I used at the weekends for fun to go out into the countryside and back and go around the short, small lanes. It would be a very fun car, and I know it wouldn't be as bad as having a just normal Golf GTE.
I think I'd have a Tesla Roadster in the garage if I had the money as my weekend car.
That's a different level of money.
You know, they're down to about 55,000 US now. You can
get
one.
Don't say that.
And there's actually a crashed one. Not that I've been looking. There's a crashed one on eBay right now for about $5,000. It's one of the first gen. It's one of the first gen that's been upgraded with the gearbox.
Nice.
Because you can see where it used to have the 2-speed gearbox, and now it's obviously been upgraded. Just saying, Mark. But anyway, back to the story. The GTE 31 miles EV only range on the NEDC cycle. For those who are listening for the first time, NEDC cycles in Europe are optimistic, shall we say. If we talk about fuel cycle tests around the world and which ones are the most optimistic, it's the Japanese JC08 test cycles. I don't know quite how they derive them, but it's almost as if there are little animated characters pushing the car along for half of the test, because you know they rate the Leaf at 200 kilometers on a charge or whatever. The NEDC test cycles are a little bit more realistic. The EPA are the most realistic tests now worldwide, which might come to a shock to our American listeners, but they are. So if you think NEDC is more optimistic than EPA, 31 miles on that test cycle probably translates to about 20 to 25 in real world.
Yeah, 20.
20 if you're careful. Yeah. But I think this is an important car because it's a Golf, and Golf's got such a heritage. 40 years old this year, isn't it, Golf?
So yeah, something like that.
40 years old this year. I've owned a Golf. You've owned a Golf, Mark? I don't know if you've ever owned any Volkswagen, Seth.
Nope.
I do like the build. I'm a fan of the car. Obviously, I had an electric Golf, so it was slightly different. Talking of the electric Golf, when it comes out, the e-Golf will have DC quick charge capabilities. The GTE doesn't, obviously, because it's got a gasoline engine. So I think I'd probably still choose the e-Golf. It doesn't seem to have the paddle shift for regen either. So, you know, but it's horses for courses. And I think Volkswagen's doing the right thing because it's the MQB platform, designed from the ground up to be completely
drivetrain agnostic.
Yes, thank you, Mark. You put words into my mouth there. I needed the help. And the battery pack's completely under the floor. It's not like Ford. I think Ford's completely, well, we've talked about this before, Ford's completely screwed up its drivetrain systems with, you know, battery packs intruding into the car. But staying with Geneva, self-driving cars. Seth, I don't know how you feel about self-driving cars. Autonomous driving technology.
I like the idea.
Would you get one?
So, you know, I don't know if it's going to be a jump. Like, we go from, you know, our smart cruise control to where I can go to sleep in the back and arrive at the place, my destination. But, you know, as cruise control gets a little smarter, and, you know, maybe, you know, the turns start working and the wheels start working, and you can kind of just go on the highway for unlimited time, and then you turn off cruise control when you're on surface streets. you know, that kind of thing makes sense. And I'm a fan of that. But I probably wouldn't, you know, Google cars, and I think Tesla's working on these as well. I'm not quite ready to relinquish control just yet. And, you know, to be honest, I haven't really driven in a Google car or any other. I know Nissan has one that they've been working on with the Leaf. But I'm very excited about that. And, you know, in 10 years, if everybody's electric and everybody's got navigation systems in their car, you know, all the cars on the road today are going to be pretty much valueless.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I agree. And I think, like Mark said, it's going to be fun drives at the weekend. But on the subject of autonomous cars, we've talked about this car before. It's the Rinspeed XJ. Mark, go on, you do it. You do it so well.
What,
You did the hand movement.
I don't understand the random capital. It does seem to be limited into EV and eco companies. It's like, we must have random capitals in the middle of end of words.
But they do, and it seems to have created enough hype. So the XGen G, however we're going to call it, answers on the back of a postcard to the broom cupboard. This car has been, you know, talked about before and previewed before, but we haven't known about it. It's due to be unveiled, by the way, in Geneva at the motor show. And Rinspeed is the company that brought us the underwater Lotus, and it's brought us bamboo cars, and it's brought us, I mean, this is proper concept car stuff. Essentially, if you think of Rinspeed as being the company, the car company, or they're not really the car company, design house, that brings everybody the weird, wacky cars that were too wacky for regular automakers to feel brave enough to display at auto shows, lest their board of directors fires them. And this one this year is based on a Tesla Model S, and the XGen G is based on the Model S, and it is an autonomous driving car of the future. There's a very swish YouTube video showing this couple wearing very kind of Jetson-y, future-y clothes. And they're nicely coordinated as well. I don't know if you noticed that. Very young, thin couple who were going out for a ride in their Model S, and they turned the front seats around and they put their feet up on the rear seats, and there was this big, large, I think it was something like a 50-inch LCD screen at the back, HD or 4K, sorry, displaying this wonderful, you know, movie or whatever that they were watching while their car drives along. Unfortunately, on one of the shots, if you look very carefully in one of the shots of them driving along, you can see the car that's towing them.
Oh,
just
that's
on top of the, because obviously it was on a dolly, and you can just see the top of this towing car in just one of the shots for about half a second. If anybody can identify what car it is, I'll be so impressed. Just from
the
roof.
You've been watching that video quite a lot.
I have been trying to figure it out, which is kind of sad. But I don't think this is the future for autonomous cars. I think autonomous cars are still going to be your standard 4-seat, 5-seat family cars. And the autonomy will be, the front seats might swivel round. So I would quite like it if I was on a long trip and I had an autonomous car to swivel my front seats around and talk to my kids in the back seat. But anybody who's got kids will tell you, especially ones who are approaching teenagehood as fast as my two are, all they really want to do is to play on their iPhone or read their Kindle or text their friends or watch a movie. They don't want to interact with their old parents.
So we're back to the Simpsons bubble car.
We're back to Simpsons bubble car. Yeah, the Homer. Somebody needs to make me the Homer. That's basically all I'm going to say. Hey, look, it's ad time, Mark.
Yay!
So you want to tell everybody about what our ads mean?
So we, if you're watching live, you won't see an ad here. But if you're not watching live, there'll be a little ad break here. We use these. And please, if you've got an ad blocker, switch it off, because these bring us a little bit of money in, which covers our hosting. Me and Nikki are doing this at the moment to try and make a living out of it, to try and bring you even more content, even more shows. At the moment, we make nothing. We're just about covering our hosting and other
bills. Well, we make enough to cover our hosting, but that's not really a living. It's breaking even. Yes.
So basically, watch the ads. Go make a cup of tea or something while it's running. Don't tell Google you're doing that, though. And if Google asks, you watch the ads. Yes. And we get a little bit of money, and it helps us carry on doing this. And then we can do this forever and bring you all the wonderful content that you want.
So essentially, watch the ad. We will be right back. So we're back. Wonderful Mark Chatterley and Seth Weinstrass. Am I saying that right?
Weintraub.
Weintraub. There you go.
It's not easy.
So we're talking about Tesla now. Tesla's had just the craziest week. Okay, so Sunday last week, and this is your story, Seth. Someone said, oh, you know that the acquisitions guy from Apple has been at Tesla. This happened back in November, October time last year.
Mm-hmm.
Tesla's going to be bought by Apple. Ooh. And we did lots of stories going, nah, don't be stupid. It's going to be battery tech, or it's going to be some kind of autonomous tech, or it's going to be a collaborative effort to get, you know, the two companies working more closely together. Apple and Tesla have met together in the past. But the downside of the upside of this was it in the stock short soared. The stock soared, that's a tongue twister, to over $200 per share, which is phenomenal, right? So tell us more.
Well, I mean, it's been up around 190 for a few months, and then it went down and then back up. So it's not a huge, I think perhaps the actual gain is because of the Elon Musk has been talking about off and on, earnings calls and other areas. The reason that so the Gigafactory is a term that Tesla uses for a battery factory that will be located in the U.S. And its capacity, when fully running, will be the equivalent or more, so they say, than all the current ion battery production in the world. So it's significant. And what's important to think about here is that if Tesla is going to make a mass market car, I mean, Nissan already has a battery factory in Tennessee. And strangely enough, they called it the Gigafactory on a couple of occasions. But that's enough to produce, I think I read somewhere, maybe 80,000 cars a year. And that's smaller battery packs, I think about a third of the size in the Leaf as a 200 mile battery pack that Tesla is probably going to try to get into their car. It's not just an order of magnitude bigger factory, but because of the economies of scale and some new technology that they're bringing in, you're going to be able to get a 30-40% cost savings for Tesla when they build this factory,
and it's which phenomenal.
Yeah, I mean, that's a big deal. That's the batteries are obviously a huge, probably the biggest expense in electric cars now anyway. So chopping 30 to 40% off of that is going to make a lot of headway in getting a 200-mile range car down into the 30,000-ish price
now,
range.
I've heard some rumors this week citing Nevada as a possible site for this gigafactory. Now I always assumed that it was going to be, you know, fairly close to the Fremont facility, but in all honesty, it's not that far over the mountains, is it?
No, it's not that bad. I mean, it depends where in Nevada, but
I'm thinking northern Nevada, I guess. So, you know.
Yeah, I mean, it could be much, much further, but you know, obviously Tesla could build a couple electric trucks and there you go. Right.
Yeah, just deliver fresh batteries every day. Right. Now, from Apple's point of view, and this is something Mark and I have been batting backwards and forwards this week. Apple, for the last couple of years, has been really pushing towards the concept of reclaiming its products as being American made.
Yep.
now, and that's, you know, amidst a whole number of different things coming together. You know, Apple obviously wants to support economy in the US, but also it's come under fire, really under fire, over the last decade for the work conditions and the pay of its workers in China. Bringing working with Tesla to buy Tesla battery packs, that would give Apple everything it needed to buy US made batteries and actually claim maybe 100% or very close to it manufacturing, right?
Right. So there's a lot of synergy. Kind of surprisingly that nobody really picked up on it before this. You know, obviously Apple's a huge buyer of lithium ion batteries. Every product they make has a battery in it, from, you know, the bigger ones in the MacBook Pros to the smaller ones in the iPods and, you know, maybe a watch. So Apple would have a huge interest, especially if they could cut 30 to 40% off the price of their lithium batteries in the process. And Apple's also known to invest heavily. They have got all the cash in the world. They've invested in RAM. They've invested in screens before. They've invested in the building of factories beforehand in order to get in the long run, a cheaper price on the
right.
production.
Right.
So this would be, I mean, this fits right down Apple's MO if you follow Apple. And obviously, you know, the Mesa, Arizona plant where they're building Sapphire for the next iPhone kind of fits in this, the same narrative where they're investing in American companies. I mean, you know, American manufacturing a little bit more. They're also, Elon Musk has said this is going to be a very green factory. It's going to probably produce more electricity from, you know, solar and other means than it actually takes off the grid. This is like, you know, reading off of Apple's sustainability report.
Right.
Like, this is exactly how they operate.
Absolutely.
So it's like, if you follow both companies like I do, and I think you guys do too, when you read these kind of things, it's like, oh, this makes perfect sense. Apple would love to get involved with something like this.
And it's also worth remembering, and I think people have been blind to this in the past, Tesla is not averse to working with other people. I think Tesla is often portrayed by the mainstream media, specifically more right-leaning media, as being this kind of renegade company that's a troublemaker. You know, those hipsters on the West Coast, they're causing trouble, they're not working with anyone, they're doing their own thing, they're breaking the rules, they're selling their cars, you know, illegally in all these different states, you know, not using dealers, etc., etc. But the reality is, Tesla is very open to working with other companies. I mean, you know, already, I mean, I'm just looking at the Q4 earnings call. Tesla made a bunch of money. I think it was $15 million. That's not much, you know, for a company of Tesla's size, but a lot for me. Made a fair amount from development work for both Mercedes-Benz or Daimler, sorry, and Toyota. You know, Toyota RAV4 EV is a Tesla engineered drivetrain and battery pack. Same for the Smart for 2 ED and also the soon to be launched B-Class eDrive. So, you know, and let's not forget, were it not for Toyota, less for Toyota's custom, but were it not for Daimler, we wouldn't have Tesla today. I mean, Elon Musk's been very clear about that. You know, it was that bailout, that, well, will you make these for us? Approach from Daimler that saved Tesla from death. The financials for Q4 last year, very interesting. The share price after hours went to 217, which I think is one of the highest it's been. As a side note, if you had invested about $9,500 in Tesla stock when Tesla had its IPO, you could now buy a fully kitted out Model S.
That makes me feel
with
a
all
upset.
The bells and whistles.
Yeah.
We're not allowed to have stock in EV companies, Mark. I'm just reminding you that.
At the time, I
you
wasn't doing this.
An EV person.
I do have a completely wild, out of the left field theory about what they could have talked about, or one of the things that Apple and Tesla could have talked about. It was spurred by a comment on our site over the weekend, or on Friday, I think it was, talking about how Tesla's actually collecting a very large amount of data in terms of battery sales, battery usage, how people drive, all of this. Apple also creates a huge amount of data and gathers a huge amount of data. iPhones and iDevices are always talking back to Apple about what they're doing, where they are, how they're doing things. And processing that data is actually an incredibly hard job. Mm-hmm. And when you think about Google and NASA, who both have bought and are sharing one of the first quantum computers made by D-Wave to crunch those data things.
Yeah.
And NASA is a natural rival to Tesla because, well, not to Tesla, but to Elon Musk because of SpaceX. And Google is a natural-ish rival to Apple. I wondered if maybe they talked about any point possibly joint purchasing another quantum computer from D-Wave to crunch some of that data. Because we're moving into an era where if you have the ability to crunch that data, you will become a massive company very quickly because loads of people have this data and just can't crunch it. It's completely out of left field. But
hey, it's a good idea. I hadn't thought of that.
Well, let me throw a couple curveballs in there. First, the Apple guy was the acquisitions guy. So
yeah,
it doesn't quite make sense that
a
map guy. Also, SpaceX does. It's not really an enemy of NASA. It's more of an enemy of, you would say, Boeing. The other.
Okay, yeah, that's true.
So, I mean, Tesla has all these contracts with NASA, and they're, you know, they're flying to the space station. And so Tesla and NASA get on, I mean, SpaceX and NASA get along okay. But, I mean, you know, there's all kinds of ideas. Like, those are just as good as any of the other ideas. For me,
I'm taking that as high praise.
I think it's as journalists, I think we're just going to be one of those, we are very privileged to be at that point in the world where we are covering someone like Elon Musk.
Oh,
because it's like very the true. Early days of Apple. I mean, it is mind blowing.
If you could buy shares in a person,
Elon Musk. Yeah. It is crazy. Talking about people with big personalities, Maximum Bob is now chair of Via Motors. Now, Mark, you don't like electric pickup trucks, and we had a bit of a back and forth on our thought of the day this week about it. And I on Friday's thought of the day, I said, look, electric trucks, pickup trucks are so needed in the US because...
I think my point is slightly different. I think that trucks themselves are innately a product of need, as in they have developed of, we need to store a huge amount of stuff, let's put this big hole in the back, and it hasn't really been thought about. They have just grown organically, and I believe if you sat down and thought about it, you could probably come up with a much more efficient design to carry exactly the same amount of weight, which would use energy in a much more efficient way. I guess I want to see efficiency rolled out, and that does mean looking at design of things. And I think trucks, even though they're iconic, their shape isn't the most energy efficient shape, and you could improve upon that.
You're probably right, actually. I hadn't thought about that. But I mean, the other interesting thing to note is obviously the father of the Chevy Volt is Bob Lutz by a lot of people's reckonings. And Bob's been horrible about electric cars in the past. He's been positive about them. He said some really horrible things about Tesla over the years. But with him back in charge, this is the guy who doesn't seem to be able to retire. He must be rapidly approaching his 90s, Seth.
I don't know if he's 90. I think he's in his 70s.
Yeah,
He's a cigar smoker, so...
Yes.
You know, maybe the age, I don't know. but he is an incredibly interesting character. I'm sure you've seen Revenge of the Electric Car and everything. So, you know, on one hand, he was obviously involved in GM's kind of bungled electric car history. And then, you know, he did do a lot to bring the Volt around. But now, I mean, if you listen to him talk, I saw this one thing on the BBC not too long ago where he made a statement that a lot of the fleets that were buying these cars were saving more money because of the price difference between electricity and gas than actually the cost of the truck. So they were, you know, they were running these cars all these trucks all day, and who cares about the environment in this case? Like, it's just a money thing. They're actually saving a lot of money before they even, you know, buy the fuel. I think because he was so exposed to the electric car phenomenon, he's kind of gone from a anti-hero to perhaps a hero. But I think he's more pragmatic about the thing. I mean, he's gone on the record saying he doesn't believe in global warming and other stuff. But I mean, on one hand, you know, that's kind of nuts. But on the other hand, like, okay, so you've got a guy who's into the electric for other reasons, for the pragmatism of it. And that's kind of actually a good thing, because he can speak to those folks who, you know, who aren't necessarily as concerned about the environment. And when you think about it, if you take a couple trucks, and this is using Bob Lutz's words, if you can take a couple gas guzzling trucks off the road, it's a lot bigger of a difference than taking a couple, you know, Chevy Malibus off the road that, you know, they get 40 miles per gallon. If you can get a couple of these 10 mile per gallon things off the road, you're really going to save some petroleum burning and some carbon. So I kind of like what he's doing. I like VIA. And
I can't wait to test drive them. I met one of the VIA guys a couple of weeks ago, actually.
Yeah.
In DC. Yeah.
I would love to test one as well. I mean, I'm sure, you know, I've driven a few electric cars. We also have a Prius plug-in.
Right.
Which I don't think is a great electric car. But, and, you know, I've test driven the Leaf, which I liked, and a bunch of other stuff. And I imagine the trucks are going to be the same. What's kind of strange to me, though, is that they're built on the same platform as the gas versions. So there's got to be a lot of, like, overlap or some wasted.
Yeah, and there's also the trucks roll off the production line in their complete gasoline format, and then they're delivered to Mexico where they're decommissioned and then recommissioned.
Right.
So they strip out a lot of the gas stuff and then they put new bits in. And I mean, it's still got a V6 engine. But I've got to give it to Bob. I like the idea of the VIA trucks. I think they're great, all power to them. And I think
I was just going to say, if Bob Lutz can do this, if Bob Lutz has got to the point where he's seeing the money in electrifying things.
He is a businessman first, though. I think we should. Yes. Yeah, he's a businessman first.
But that he's paving the way for other of the other big Detroit names and other American companies to go, Bob Lutz is getting behind electric cars and plugging electric cars. And that's got to be a good thing. That's got to have got a couple of high up chairmen of various automotive companies going, crap, Bob Lutz is doing this. It means it must be good. I think that, if nothing else, is going to help.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry for interrupting.
All right, let's move on. Cutting the cord. And we don't mean, you know, getting rid of your cable TV service. Although last week, those of you, it's probably a good point, isn't it, Mark, to say why we didn't have a show last week. We were halfway through the show and my cable internet here is 125 down and about 12 up. Mark, stop shaking your head in disgust.
I'm just jealous.
You chose to live in the countryside. And during the show, we had problems with our connection. For some reason, it caused the program that we stream all of the show to the internet. It caused it to panic. It caused it to force quit. That caused a kernel panic, which brought down the main studio machine.
And everything went.
Killed everything. Single point of failure. But we're not talking about that. But I just wanted to apologize. That's why there was no show last week. So if you're listening, this will be your first show for 2 weeks. But cord cutting. This couple in Florida, Matthew Cummings and Jennifer Brown, they live in a high-rise condo. Apartment in a gated community in Venice, Florida. And they've talked publicly about their electric cars or electric cars before. they've had a bit of a run in the past, being charged a fairly extortionate amount, or refused to charge their car by the homeowners association because they said it was going to cost a lot to charge it. $25 of power in 3 months is what they've reckoned. But the homeowners association said it would be far more than that and they couldn't possibly do it. They did eventually get permission to plug their car in and charge it. But then on Monday, February 3rd, their vault activated its alarm and alerted them via OnStar that someone had unplugged their car. They went downstairs and found out that their charging cable had been snipped, literally snipped.
Yeah, actually cut, which I'm guessing if it was charging would have been quite a dangerous thing to do.
But the thing about those cables is those J1772 cables are quite thick, aren't they? I mean, you'd need a pair of garden shears or something to do that.
Yeah. And yes, but literally cut right beneath the gun handle that goes into the car. I don't understand it. It's just wanton vandalism. I mean, if you don't agree with something, do you go out and cut someone's power cord?
Well, I'm not sure if this was someone objecting to them plugging in their car in the condo and, you know, presumably using communal electricity for it, even though they'd finally agreed to do it, or whether it was just some random vandal, or whether it was someone who had a problem with the family and decided to take it out on their car. And that's not particularly clear, is it?
No, there are quite a few gaps in this. There was a lot of supposition in some of the reports that came out, and guess what? But the fact of the matter is someone cut the charging cord for this car.
That's not on. I've never had any problems like that. Seth, have you anyone tried to cut your cord on your Model S?
No. But I had heard of something happening. I think somebody vandalized one of the supercharger stations, but I can't remember what the deal was.
I mean, I've heard and seen vandalized charging stations before. I know there was a couple in Maryland not too long ago. I want to say in Bethesda, but I'm not sure if it was. I remember I covered it.
We've seen vandalized charging stations in the UK.
Someone kicked in
the back of a DC rapid charger in the UK, which caused it to detect it wasn't venting properly, so it stopped before it overheated.
And I have actually, now you mention it, at that same location, Mark, which is Birmingham M42. I was there, sort of just standing around, when someone walked up and said, we should unplug the car. It was two guys. They were obviously a little bit drunk, coming back from a football match. Oh, we should unplug that. And I just walked past, and that deterred them from doing it. And I'm quite glad, because it was my car.
When I was coming back from the Wave last year with Kevin Sharp in the Roadster, we were staying overnight in a hotel just outside. Oh, I can't remember where we were now. But charging up overnight, they had a charging station. And at about 3 a.m, we would have been absolutely fine with this overnight charge, would have been absolutely perfect. Someone had come along, and on the Roadsters, all you needed to do was sort of slide a little locking pin on the top of the charger, and it stops the car charging, and that stops the car charging, which we still had enough to make our journey the next day, but it changed what could have been a very nice, easy trip in the Roadster into one where we had to pay a little bit more attention. And it's just, I don't understand the mentality behind it, I guess, is where it is. And we know people who've been unplugged multiple times in the UK, and it's just, I don't know whether it's jealousy that drives it, but then there's a difference between feeling jealous or feeling upset and I disagree with what you're doing, and then actively doing something against it. It's a whole other level, which I don't understand.
Go on, tell us about the letter that you got through your letterbox this week, because you were really excited about that.
I am. I'm going to write a story about this. I got a letter from my local police community officer, so proper policeman who just looks after my little village, passed through all the letterboxes in my road, saying that there has been an increase in car related crimes in the area, which is odd because I'm in a little village in the middle of nowhere. And lots of cars have been having a very exclusive
school in your village.
Yeah. I know there's a couple of boarding schools down the road, but lots of catalytic converters have been being stolen from cars, and I was advised to keep an eye on my car in case my catalytic converter goes walkabouts in an evening. So that's another bonus of having an EV. I don't have to worry about someone stealing my catalytic converter for
maybe what you should do. I wish, you know, it would be a crime to do it, but wouldn't it be fun if fun wind up? Someone's stolen my catalytic converter. I'm not recommending you do that, though. That would be naughty. All right, moving on.
Police time, yeah.
Moving on. Toyota Prius is kind of, I suppose, the undisputed king of hybrid cars. This week, Honda has announced it's withdrawing the Insight Hybrid and the CRZ, or the CRZ, from Europe. Because no one's buying it because of diesel cars. Now, you know, okay, we're not really that interested in hybrids, but that same challenge from diesel is causing plug-ins to suffer as well, isn't it, Mark?
I was looking at the
you were
chat room
at something
and
else.
I was completely not listening.
Diesel cars have caused the Insight no longer to be sold. And I think that could happen to plugins as well, don't you?
Definitely, especially in the UK and Europe, where diesel is seen as the clean alternative. It is very much pushed as, if you want a clean car, get a diesel. And because everyone focuses on CO2 rather than any other emissions.
Particulates.
And so there are fewer people who buy hybrid cars because hybrid cars, up until very recently, didn't get many more miles per gallon compared to a decent diesel. And some of these diesels were actually pretty good cars. So a lot of people bought the diesels instead.
That's not happening in the US, thankfully, but there is at least talk that the Insight and the CRZ are going to be pulled in the US as well.
It's sad, but like they're not... I mean...
They're not great cars.
No, they're not great cars. I mean, if you're going to get a hybrid, like the Prius, there's nothing better about the Insight besides it's usually sold cheaper.
Yeah, I mean, the
Prius.
The best Prius hybrid, I think, on sale at the moment in the US is the Prius C. I think it's a great little car.
Yeah.
I think it's a great little car for most people. And then obviously you've got the V and the regular, the original, I suppose, that they call it the... They don't call it the hatchback, they call it something else. But it's a great car. And the plug-in hybrid, I just hope that Toyota doesn't stop making it, rather that they improve it and make it better, because it's got so much promise and lets every promise drop to the curb, doesn't it?
Right, that's the problem. I mean, this is my first electric car, and thankfully I stuck with electric cars, but we bought it because you get like about 10 or 15 miles per charge. And we were like, okay, you know, we take our kids to school. We do a lot of sub 10 mile per hour treks throughout the day in one of our cars. The other car we go to work in. so we were like, okay, no problem. This is going to just be an electric car. And then every once in a while, we'll need it for gas. Not so. If you want to heat the car, if you want to turn on the windshield wipers or do anything, the gas engine kicks in. If you want to, I mean, even you can be riding down a road, down a hill on a hot day with nothing on the Prius on, the plug-in Prius with plenty of battery power, and all of a sudden the engine turns on.
Yeah.
No idea why.
It's horrible.
It would be nice if there was they don't really do this, but it would be nice if there was a firmware update where it says,
yep,
you can put it in electric mode, you can put it in regular mode, but when you're in electric mode, the engine doesn't turn on until the battery is dead. And if that were the case, it would be a great car.
You see, in Europe, you do have that EV mode button.
That's what I've heard.
Yeah, and we do have the EV mode button, but in all fairness, I think the best Toyota Prius plug-in hybrid has been the self-converted ones, and that's speaking as someone who had one, mm-hmm. who blew one up. Because I was stupid and didn't check my battery management system properly. But, you know, I mean, I could do sort of 25 miles in EV range, and I could drive at 40 miles an hour, and it was great, and I loved it.
And this was a long time ago, really.
This was 2008?
I mean, in terms of technology, that's a long time ago.
That's right. Like two centuries ago. It's a shame. All right, moving on. So, Cadillac ELR. We talked last week about what kind of person buys a cabbie ELR because of the ad that was just totally arrogant.
Oh yeah,
that totally was turned me off the car, and I was already not that much of a fan of it. $75,000, I think it is. Interestingly, half of caddy dealers are even refusing to sell it.
Wow,
that's how bad the car is, and I think it's just competition from Tesla. I mean, if you imagine for a second that Tesla didn't exist, then probably the Caddy ELR wouldn't exist. But just let's assume for a second that Tesla didn't exist, and the Caddy ELR was kind of the car that you would maybe consider buying. It's essentially just a Chevy Volt in a tuxedo, and I think that's why it's just not worth the price. What's that matter, Mark?
So it's the equivalent. It's the car equivalent of me dressing up in a suit, is what we're saying. It just doesn't work.
By the way, I should probably mention, I've got a friend who works as a producer for a TV station in, I think he's in Minnesota, and he made a comment about your banana shirt in our Tesla Model S review and said, "I just kept watching, going, oh my God, I would never wear that on television." I tried to explain to him that it's become a bit of a thing for our fans, hasn't it? The banana jumper. So it's the equivalent of you and your banana jumper, Mark. Anyway, yes. Time for another ad break. We will be right back. Please do watch the ads. We will be back. On to the final part of the show. And we're going to black through these so that we don't overrun the show too much. We're coming up on our hour, so we're going to try and finish as tightly as we can. BMW has been promising for a long time that the i3 Rex, or the BEVX as it's going to be called in California, will be eligible for the green HOV lane sticker, meaning you can get single occupant access to the HOV lanes, the high occupancy vehicle lanes, if you have one of these green stickers on the back of your car. If you've got an EV, you're eligible for the white sticker. The white stickers are unlimited in number. California will just keep giving them out until there's no more EVs left for them. The green stickers are limited to 40,000. And by the end of May, or by the beginning of May, it is predicted, using the current rate at which they're being allocated, which is about 90 a day, it is expected that those green stickers will run out by the end of April, beginning of May. Now, BMW has been telling us for weeks and weeks and weeks and months that the i3 BEVX or Rex will be eligible for the green sticker in California. Earlier this week, CARB's official list, the HOV lane eligibility list on the California Air Resources Board's website, added the i3 EV, or the i3 BEV, as they call it. And lots of people got in contact with us, Mark, about this and went, hang on, the i3 has appeared on the list as being eligible for the white sticker. The i3 Rex has not appeared. What's going on? So we reached out to BMW. BMW was extremely coy about this all. Couldn't get any official quotes from anyone in BMW other than the original quote from a couple of months back, which said this car is engineered to satisfy to the green HOV lane exemption and the stickers will run out at the end of the year.
Yeah, that it was very much, relax, we got the whole year, would be my paraphrase of that.
I don't want to put anyone in hot water, so I'm going to say I did more digging. How about that? I spoke to lots of people, and I did speak. I spent most of Friday on the phone speaking to lots of different people. None of them would give me a quote. This is how everybody's feeling about this. Nobody would give me a quote. Nobody at the Air Resources Board, nobody at BMW. They couldn't tell me if the car had been submitted. When I asked, everyone went, I prefer not to say. My inferring of that is that BMW has hit a roadblock with this car and its certification for California HOV lane access exemption. And I don't think if you live in California and you're considering getting an i3 Rex, I think you should really be prepared for the fact that you're not going to be able to sit in the carpool lane. And as anybody who's driven in downtown LA, anyone who's driven around the Bay Area in the rush hour can tell you, the HOV lanes can save you, it can cut your journey time in half or more, can't they, Seth?
Oh, absolutely.
What do you think BMW's up to?
I honestly don't know. This seems kind of like a behind the scenes negotiations are happening. You know, I wouldn't even want to guess because I don't know. I don't know what the motivations on either side are, and I don't know what the expectations are really either.
I get the impression that both sides are a little exasperated. Let's put it like that.
Yeah.
And I also get the impression that I reckon there's something wrong with the emissions, because it's emissions as well as mode of operation. And I reckon it's something's not gone quite right on the emissions, the cold cycle test, or something, the way the engine operates, the way the engine turns on, and something has not quite met requirements, and now they're struggling to put it back together. That's just my guess.
So the range extender, the range extender is a I think it's a two-stroke engine?
I believe so. Three-cylinder.
I mean,
a three-cylinder.
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 I mean, I would imagine it's a, it's a, you know, a BMW knows how to make engines. It's not going to be something, you know, totally insane. And if the Volt, which kind of uses the same idea, where they, you know, you run on electricity and then when you start to run out of electricity, then the engine kicks in. I mean, it should theoretically have the same status as the Volt. So it's hard to say.
Now, this is the interesting thing, because when the Volt first came out, it wasn't eligible for the green sticker. And and we know, we've talked about this before, haven't we, Mark? It was to do with the emissions, the tailpipe emissions.
Just slightly too high. It
just
was a
slightly
fraction,
too high.
They were very
and it was
close.
Just over. And so if you buy an early Chevy Volt that is not California spec, you can't go in the HOV lanes, even if you take it to California. You have to buy one of the ones that was specifically made to pass the California Air Resources Board. It's now, I think, nationwide, so all cars after the 2013s or the 2012s comply. Okay. But how they got around it was, I believe, they added an air pump into the exhaust, or a valve that added, that essentially diluted the exhaust enough so the volume of air coming out of the back was slightly higher, and therefore the parts per million dropped.
Yeah, and I believe it was the engine equivalent of moving the sensor about 3 inches further away from the exhaust.
Interesting. So maybe BMW is working on a quote-unquote fix like that.
Yeah, maybe. All right, now talking about air, Peugeot's come up with a hybrid air technology, which it says it's going to debut in 2016. In the Peugeot 2008, for those who don't know, Peugeot has decided, in its infinite wisdom, Peugeot for years has been using numbers rather than names for its cars. And now it's not going to make any new numbers up. It's just going to keep reusing those numbers ad infinitum until it changes its mind. This means the 2008 is going to continue to be the 2008, even though the car itself that is attached to that may change over the years. We're talking a hybrid air car. So it uses a gasoline engine, which can then use the engine turns off like it would in a Prius, and then an air hydraulic motor or a pneumatic motor kicks in and pushes the car along. The fuel economy levels are not as good as they are for a conventional hybrid car, but Peugeot says this is the future. It's going to be better than electric. Now, from a cost analysis point of view, I guess it's cheaper because you don't have to buy the lithium-ion battery packs. From a safety point of view, carrying around compressed tank of air, it is just air.
Has the ability to put out a car fire.
Sorry?
If your car catches fire and the compressed air tank opens up, it could put out the fire. It's a self-extinguishing car.
79 mpg US. 94 mpg Imperial. So it's at the high end. I don't see this catching on because air engines are so noisy. All the air cars I've seen are really noisy. They're not quiet. Maybe this would like kill two birds with one stone. Seth, do you think this is going to catch on?
No, not at all.
I mean, pneumatic engines have been around a long time, 100 plus years. But
right. And if they were going to catch on, I think they would have already. For me, and you could store energy in pressurized air. You can store energy in what's the other thing? Oh, they had like the, what's that rotating wheel, that very heavy rotating wheel?
The KERS, yeah.
I mean, they have all these other ways of storing energy, but like for pure energy density, I think it's been already shown that besides fossil fuels, that lithium ion batteries and perhaps, you know, some other new technologies that are, you know, battery forms are yeah. going to kind of win out. There's just no way that these other forms of energy are going to become as efficient as batteries.
And talking about that, I mean, I'm just giving Mark a head up now. Mark, we're going to switch the penultimate two stories around.
Okay, that's fine by me.
We're going to talk about safety now. We're going to talk about hydrogen. There's a very interesting article on ProPublica about how safe hydrogen fuel cell vehicles are, because obviously lots of companies are talking about it. I'm just going to read you a couple of paragraphs. It was just before 3 p.m. on Thursday afternoon. Traffic was moving slowly along the Pomona Freeway, about 20 miles outside downtown Los Angeles. Suddenly, a truck carrying compressed hydrogen caught fire, and by the time the local fire department had arrived on scene, two of the hydrogen tanks had begun venting gas. The flames had engulfed the truck's cab. It took almost 7 hours for firefighters working with a mix of chemicals and water to end the threat. It had the full spectrum of colours, Captain Will Pryor of the LA County Fire Department recalled of the fire on November 14th. It's like a log in a fire. You have blue parts of it, orange parts of it. But this was a massively long fire, 7 hours.
And what's talking about the colours, pure hydrogen burns with an invisible flame.
Yes.
So there would have been parts of that fire we couldn't see, which is terrifying. If you think about it, there is a chance a hydrogen pump, or there could be a hydrogen leak, which is on fire, and you wouldn't be able to tell other than the heat as you approached it.
This is the other thing. There have been 37 recorded events in recent years involving hydrogen trucks or fueling stations. Of the 22 events recorded at fueling stations, hydrogen was released in a dozen of them, and twice the releases resulted in fires. Fires occurred in 5 of the 15 recorded events involving hydrogen trucks. This is not like the Tesla fires. There have been, what, 5 Tesla fires so far?
Well, if you...
And they were results of accidents.
Yeah. There's 2 garage fires, 3 car fires.
Right. And so, 37 versus 5. And they're not even on the market yet. That's the thing I want to add.
And that's just one of the parts. It's one of the most reactive elements we know. It just wants to bond with everything else. It's kind of its job in nature. And we're talking about it in a compressed state and cooled as well. So it also eats away and wears away metal. So over time, the tanks that are holding it either have to be made of something incredibly expensive or be replaced, because it corrodes. And I don't know the official term, maybe it's not corroding, but it will wear down the tanks it's in. It can escape from the tanks because the particles are small enough to slip through the atoms and the what's holding together the canisters. It's just a ridiculous idea. Driving around with this tanks of this thing in your car is a really weird idea, and I can only think there's a massive amount of funding going to people in government that they're even considering allowing these cars on the road.
It's ludicrous, isn't it? Really, it really.
My understanding of physics is completely wrong, but I'm fairly sure it's not completely wrong.
I just want to see more safety. I really do. I really want to do. Let's move to our and finally, because this is a good one for Mark. Mark, you and I were at a Renault event this week on Monday, and we drove petrol cars.
We did.
Really sorry, people. We drove petrol cars. There is a good reason behind it, because we talked about this. We've been talking about this for months, Mark and I, off air. Our job as journalists is to be able to explain to people what these new evolved transport, that's the name of the site, Transport Evolved, what these new transportation types are like. And we have to give them an analogy based on vehicles they already know. And so in order to do that, we have to drive petrol cars that are on the market, as well as the new technologies. And so we went to a Renault press day and we drove some of Renault's conventional cars and compared them in our heads to some of the electric models we've driven. So we drove a diesel Kangoo van. We drove a Dacia Logan, which I fell in love with. And I hate to admit it, I fell in love with a petrol car.
But it would make an amazing conversion car.
It would make an amazing conversion. For those who don't know, the Dacia Logan is effectively a low budget, no frills car. And the top spec model costs $10,000. That's the one with the cruise control and the air conditioning and everything else. It's a wagon. It reminded me of my old Volvo 240, and it was lovely. Not particularly fuel efficient, but it would make a great conversion candidate. So anybody who's interested, consider it. But we also drove the Renault Clio GT, and we didn't like it, did we, Mark?
No, it was... In automatic mode, which is the standard how the car came, it was lackluster. It got a bit more pep when you switched it to
I mean, when I took it out onto the main road, you did tell me off.
Yes, but you were operating it in manual mode. Then.
Yeah, with the paddle shifting,
and it gained a bit of go then. But as a car, it didn't feel any better than the Zoe, and I kind of expected what was meant to be the sportier brand to be better,
yes.
But it started us thinking that the Zoe, one of the things that irks me about the Zoe is it's got these really aggressive looks. It has been styled to be a bit of a boy racer car, or to have some of those style elements thrown in it, but I've always found its performance hasn't quite lived up to that.
It's been a bit lackluster.
Yeah, it's perfectly capable around town, and it's an EV that I would even consider buying if I didn't have my Leaf. So it's perfectly fine, but the looks and the performance don't quite match up. And it started us thinking that maybe they should make alongside it a Zoe GT, which had a slightly larger motor in it. So it just lived up to the looks a bit more and just had that slightly faster 0-60, that slightly more tuned sporty suspension to it, and I think it would be a really good car. Not saying there's always not a good car, but it would be a car that hit a market definitely. And one of the things I found about the Zoe is it tried to straddle lots of different markets, mm-hmm. and this would put the Zoe very firmly into one market, and I think that would be a better option for Renault than trying to straddle the three markets.
And it would be good. I was thinking of other cars I'd like to see performance version of. Obviously, Tesla makes the P85 Plus, Seth. So it makes sense for other automakers to do something similar and offer a performance version of an EV.
Yeah, sure. Especially just, I mean, you know, like Chevy makes Corvettes, Dodge makes Vipers. They don't sell too well, but like it's their flagship car. It's something that, you know, you could say, well, Tesla can go 0-60 in under 4 seconds. Most Teslas don't do that, but they can, and that's what you see in the YouTubes.
So why not
make flagship?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the Zoe GT would be awesome, and get it racing, get it doing some fun stuff. You know, even if it hammers range a bit, you know, give people the option. And Nissan Renault, obviously Renault's got access to the 80 kilowatt motor out of the Leaf. It's also got access, I think, the slightly more powerful one from the Nismo. Obviously in Japan you can get a race tuned Leaf, and I wish come round to other countries, but we'll wait and see. Seth, thank you very much for joining us today. Where can people follow you?
Well, thanks for having me. I'm on Twitter at LLSethJ, and at any of my sites, 95mac.com and electrek.co.
Great.
And love to see you.
Yeah, and here's hoping there's some other big juicy stories come up this week, because that Apple Tesla story and the BMW story kept Mark and myself sane last week, because there was, frankly, to use a British term, bugger all else But yeah, as we're getting up to Geneva, hopefully there'll be more.
I think we're expecting the Gigafactory announcement.
Yeah, Gigafactory next week. And there's also some other rumblings on the grapevine. And we've got a good story tomorrow, haven't we, Mark, about another BMW story, unfortunately, that we're working on. We're waiting for BMW to get back to us on this, and they still haven't. So we're giving them as much time as we possibly can. We've half written the story. They need to get back to us. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink. Thanks to everyone watching at home. I hope you like the new setup and the new studio. It does mean that we don't have the green screen. I should look over here. I keep looking at that screen because that's the screen with all the stuff on it.
Would you say that the new studio is potato-tastic?
It says Gavin in the chat room. I guess that's Gavin Shoebridge. I don't even have to look. Is it Gavin Shoebridge?
They might be wanting me to say potato-tastic quite a lot, so I'm going to say potato-tastic a few times for them.
Oh dear, there we go. I'll give everyone a bit of a tour of the studio before we go. This is the new setup, and I want to see if everyone likes it. So which button is this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is the new studio setup. So you can see that machine there. That's the news machine, which I haven't used much today. Mixing desk, doing all the recording. There's Seth. There's Mark. There's the what's it one. And there's the chat room. Hello, chat room. That's everybody. I'm going to put that down now. And I'm going to say thanks very much for joining us. You can find us on YouTube. You can find us on iTunes. And you can find us every day at www.transportevolved.com. That's really it. And until next time, don't forget to plug in. Take care. See you soon. Bye. We'll be right back.